You know that many runners enter a race, and only one of them wins the prize. So run to win. Athletes work hard to win a crown that cannot last, but we do it for a crown that will last forever. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 through 25. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 through 8. Well, welcome once again to Wednesday Night Bible Study. My name is Carl Luther, and this is KDL Ministries. You know, as a former long-distance runner, I can so identify with Paul's analogy of our faith as a long-distance race, because that's what a life of faith is. It's a long-distance run. It's not a short sprint. And each runner must finish the race as strong as how he started. He's got to have the endurance to cross the finish line with strength. And that's how our life as a Christian should be. From the day that we accepted Jesus and made him our king, every day we should grow stronger and stronger. It's called growth. And when we get born again, we are just like babies in Christ. But throughout our life, we are required to mature and to grow spiritually. And Paul's using this analogy of an athlete to teach us how we have to finish and how we have to train and finish this thing called life. We need to run it and run it to win. So what in the world does this have anything to do with our last part of our Gideon study? Well, plenty. And actually, this concept that Paul's teaching can be applied to any Bible character who has a life story. But with Gideon, he started out like an out-of-shape athlete. God had to tell him he was a mighty man of valor. Remember that? And we just finished out with a highlight of Gideon's life. He led all of Israel and delivered them from the oppression of the Midianites. In fact, as we're about to read, Gideon became so admired, Israel wanted to make him their king. But the scriptures tell us that he declined and said that God was their king. Let's go ahead and recap that real quick. Judges chapter 8, verses 22 through 23. Then the men of Israel said to Gideon, "Rule over us, both you and your son, and your grandson also, for you have delivered us from the hand of Midian." But Gideon said to them, "I will not rule over you, nor shall my son rule over you. The Lord shall rule over you." Now, let me just interject for a minute, and this might be a newsflash for those of you who are familiar with this story. Gideon's humble response on the surface looks genuine, but as we begin to dig in here in a minute, you'll have to conclude that Gideon's response was superficial at best. And why? Well, let's just use Paul's example of running that race. Everyone who runs must run to win and cross that finish line. So tonight I want to take a look at Gideon's life and see what valuable lessons we can learn from. And what we're going to see is sometimes in life, our biggest failures can come right after our biggest victories. Failures after victory, you say? Yes. When you take your eyes off the one who gave you the ability to get success, failure is soon to follow. You know, I'm reminded of my family's pastor when I was just a young boy. His name was Ron Dunn. And I remember in one of his sermons, he taught this exact same principle, only he used the children of Israel as his example. Immediately after the children of Israel's exodus from Egypt, after seeing all of God's miracles, escaping the death of the firstborn on Passover night by the blood of the Lamb, crossing through the Red Sea on dry ground, only to see Pharaoh and his army getting swept away forever when they pursued them into the Red Sea, after all they witnessed, after all those victories, they failed. As they began their journey into the wilderness, heading to Mount Sinai, they were not even 3 days into the journey and they took their eyes off God who delivered them, and instead they looked at their situation around them. And what was that? Well, they got thirsty. And it's not so wrong that they got thirsty. That's not the issue here. It's how they acted. That was a failure. And what did they do? Well, they complained, and Moses got a battlefield promotion to the HR department. He had to deal with their complaints and their poor behavior, which is really altogether a great lesson about how God feels about his people complaining. The King James Version calls it murmuring. Let's take a look at it. It's going to be found in Exodus chapter 15, verses 22 through 24. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur. And they went 3 days into the wilderness and found no water. And when they came to Marah, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore the name of it was called Marah. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" But Pastor Dunn's point was that after success came failure. And if that was not example good enough, there is always the extreme failure with Israel's event with the golden calf. Let's recall that story because there's a certain parallel with that failure and with what we're about to read here in our Gideon story that I want to point out. Let's look at Exodus chapter 32, verses 1 through 4. Now when the people saw that Moses delayed coming down from the mountain, the people gathered together to Aaron and said to him, "Come, make us gods that shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." And Aaron said to them, "Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people broke off the golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he received the gold from their hand, and he fashioned it with an engraving tool and made a molten calf. Then they said, "This is your God, O Israel, that brought you up out of the land of Egypt." Now, man, that's a really good example of failure coming after victory. So how did Gideon fail? Well, let's continue on with a reading in Judges. After the leaders of Israel wanted to make Gideon and his sons king, this is what Gideon said. Let's look at Judges chapter 8, verse 24. Then Gideon said to them, "I would like to make a request of you that each of you would give me the earrings from his plunder." For they had golden earrings because they were Ishmaelites. Now, did I just hear that correctly? What did he ask for? The same thing that Aaron asked for. And what did Gideon do with those earrings? Well, let's find out. Judges chapter 8, verses 24 through 27. So they answered, "We will gladly give them." And they spread out a garment, and each man threw into it the earrings from his plunder. Now the weight of the gold of the earrings that he requested was 1,700 shekels of gold. That's about 60 pounds of gold. Besides the crescent ornaments, pendants, and purple robes which were on the kings of Midian, and besides the chains that were around the camels' necks. Now, I want you to pay close attention to that phrase, crescent ornaments. And I'll close out my lesson and talk more about this later. Continuing. Then Gideon made it into an ephod and set it up in his city of Ophrah. And all of Israel played the harlot with it there, and it became a snare to Gideon and to his house. Okay, let's unpack what we just read and understand what's going on here. And there's an eerie similarity here, no pun intended, with the earrings that Aaron requested and the earrings that Gideon requested. Both were melted down to make an idol. But in Gideon's case, the idol was a thing called an ephod. So let's begin with the understanding of what an ephod was and why this was so unlawful for Gideon to even make. The ephod was one of many layers of garments that the high priest wore. And in order, here's a list of all those layers. First of all, there was a white linen tunic. Think of it kind of like his underwear. It had a large hole at the top for his head and then two large armholes. Its length went all the way down to his feet. It was worn sort of like a nightgown or like a long, loose-fitting shirt. And then secondly, there was a priestly robe, and it was colored blue. And it was put on like the tunic, but it was worn over it. And the robe had a bottom hem of golden bells and artistically fashioned pomegranates. And then as a high priest ministered in the Holy of Holies, the bells could be heard as he moved around. And this proved to be an indicator that he was still alive while he was doing his duties. And that's another lesson for another time. And then thirdly, there was the ephod that we're talking about. It was worn like an apron and it was put over the robe. And it was made of blue and purple and gold and scarlet thread and white linen. And two onyx stones were set in gold and attached to the shoulder straps of the ephod. And on those stones were the names of all 12 tribes of Israel. Six names on each stone. And as a high priest performed his duties in the Holy of Holies, he bore all of Israel on his shoulders as he ministered before God. The ephod was also the garment that bore the next thing that the high priest wore, the breastplate. It was attached to the ephod. Now, the breastplate and the ephod were separate pieces, but when they were worn by the high priest, they were considered to be one piece. The breastplate was a square pan-shaped garment made of the same colors of the ephod: gold, blue, purple, scarlet, and fine white linen. But the breastplate had four rows of three settings in which 12 precious stones were set in gold. Sardius, a topaz, and emeralds were set in the first row. And in the second row was set a turquoise and a sapphire and a diamond. And in the third row was set a jacinth, an agate, and an amethyst. And in the fourth row was set a beryl and an onyx and a jasper stone. And each of these stones had one name each of all 12 tribes of Israel inscribed on it. One name per stone. The stones were then attached to the breastplate in the setting of gold. Now, this elaborate breastplate was attached to the ephod through golden rings, thus making it part of the ephod as it was worn by the high priest. The picture here is that the high priest not only bore Israel on his shoulders, as with the two onyx stones that all the names of Israel were written on, but with all 12 names inscribed on those precious stones attached to the breastplate, the picture was that all of Israel was very close to the high priest's heart as he performed his duties in the Holy of Holies. So where does the ephod come into play with our story with Gideon? Well, as I said, the ephod and the breastplate were attached together when they were put on. They became one piece. And there were two other stones that were also worn by the high priest. They were called the Urim and the Thummim. Now, these two stones are to this day mysterious in their composition and their use. All we know is that they were used in some form or fashion to determine the will or the judgment of God. A yes-no question would have been asked for a yes-no answer. And depending on the outcome of the Urim and the Thummim, some would say that they would light up in some form or fashion, then the priest was able to know what God's answer was. Now, the Urim and the Thummim were put inside a pouch of some sort in between the ephod and the breastplate. Let's take a look at that. Exodus chapter 28, verse 30. And you shall put in the breastplate of judgment the Urim and the Thummim, and they shall be over Aaron's heart when he goes in before the Lord. So Aaron shall bear the judgment of the children of Israel over his heart before the Lord continually. Now that in our story, Gideon makes an ephod using the gold and the purple robes that came from the spoils of war they took off the Midianites. And it's a foregone conclusion that this ephod also included the breastplate where the Urim and Thummim were kept. So now that we have somewhat of a visual of this ephod, let's discuss the problems that arise with Gideon in making one. An ephod, particularly an ephod that was made in the fashion that God told Moses to make, that was a thing only for the high priest to wear. One does not just simply make such a garment as an ephod and claim it for himself. And why? Well, come on, by now you should know my answer. It was holy. Let's take a look at Exodus chapter 28, verse 2. And you shall make holy garments for Aaron, your brother, for glory and for beauty. So pay close attention to two things here. All those priestly garments were considered holy, and they were made exclusively for Aaron. And why Aaron? Well, because he was a high priest. And after Aaron died, then his son became the high priest. And that position was handed down from generation to generation. And these garments were not for anyone else, not even a priest, only for the high priest after the order of Aaron. And this concept of things being considered holy and only allowed for certain individuals or certain rituals is not a one-off thing. Remember the law for the special incense? Let's take a look at that. Exodus chapter 30, verses 37 through 38. But as for the incense which you shall make, you shall not make any for yourselves according to its composition. It shall be to you holy for the Lord. Whoever makes anything like it to smell it, he shall be cut off from his people. And the same law applied for the special anointing oil as well. So Gideon making this ephod as his own personal possession was completely off the chain wrong. But let's get inside Gideon's head for a minute. By all means and purposes, this ephod was used as a divination tool. It was a God-given tool to be used only by the high priest to know God's will. Now, does Gideon not have a reputation for testing God already? Remember the whole fleece thing? So Gideon already has a history of testing God. And for whatever reason, after this great victory in his life, he's fallen back into needing anything more than his faith. And he's fallen into temptation of dabbling with something that was only intended for the priestly office. And look at this way overlooked fact. Where did he set this ephod up at? Let's read it once more. Judges chapter 8, verse 27. Then Gideon made it into an ephod and set it up in his city in Ophrah. And all of Israel played the harlot with it there. It became a snare to Gideon and to his house. So we see that Gideon set this idol, because that's exactly what it turned into. It was an idol. And he put it in his own hometown of Ophrah. So what's wrong with that picture? Well, if anything of God was to be set up anywhere for his people to come to, then Ophrah was definitely not the place to do it. Shiloh was the central place of worship back then. That's where the tabernacle was at. Let's go back to Joshua and verify this. Let's go back to the book of Joshua, chapter 18, verse 1. Now the whole congregation of the children of Israel assembled together at Shiloh and set up the tabernacle of meeting there, and the land was subdued before them. So even if Gideon thought he was doing a good thing by making this ephod and setting up at a place for the people, Shiloh was a city to have done it at, not his own hometown city. Shiloh was where the Ark of the Covenant rested within the tabernacle. That's where all the priestly duties were to be performed. But as we'll continue our study in Judges, it'll be very clear that by now, even the priestly responsibilities and the support of the priests have been forsaken and neglected by all of Israel. More about that in weeks to come. So what's going on here with Gideon? Here he was so victorious in his life. He became the man. He became the judge of Israel that God used. I mean, he was almost like the Joshua of his time. So much so that, as we read earlier, the leaders of Israel wanted to make him their king, but he said no. Now, I mentioned earlier on the surface, Gideon's response looked humble, right? And I told you that as we look more into his actions, his response was more superficial, right? So what did I mean when I said that? Well, let's continue. Judges chapter 8, picking them up in verse 29. Then Jerubbaal, Gideon, the son of Joash, went and dwelt in his own house. Gideon had 70 sons who were his own offspring, for he had many wives. And his concubine, who was in Shechem, also bore him a son, whose name he called Abimelech. Okay, so Abimelech will be the main character in the next story to come. And the name Abimelech is not a new name for us. It was a common name for kings back then. It was a common name for a Canaanite king. Now, this is just another example where we can see Gideon getting off course with God. He told the people, "No, I won't be your king." But then he made an illegal ephod and he placed it in a city other than Shiloh. We just talked about that. And then he goes and names his son Abimelech after he humbly said to Israel, "No, I won't be your king." Well, do you want to learn the meaning of the name Abimelech? It means "my father is king." When broken down, we have the word Abi, which means father. This is where we get the name Abba from. Abi, my father. And then we have the word Melech, which means the king. So put together, Abimelech means "my father, the king." Now, why would Gideon give his son such a name? Because names back then meant a whole lot. They weren't just all cutesy and, "Oh, that just sounds so nice." There was meaning and purpose behind names. Now, you tell me, how did Gideon really see himself? And consider this. Only kings back then, or at best, men who had great stature and had hundreds of wives. And Gideon had 70 sons with many wives, a distinction only affordable by the very few. And remember, Gideon's clan was of the weakest of all Manasseh. It would have taken a lot of money to raise 70 boys. Now, granted, Gideon was not crowned king of Israel. The very first king was Saul, and that wouldn't happen for another several hundred years to come. But judging by Gideon's actions, he did love as such. Now, I'm not trying to get on a Gideon bash. That's not my intentions. Gideon was a God-appointed judge over Israel, and he accomplished the task that God gave him, and he did it faithfully, very faithfully. But Gideon was a human just like us. So what can we learn from his mistakes? Well, how about this? We can never allow our God-given victories to go to our head. Gideon's battle may have been won, but the race that Paul talks about, that was not over. Now that there was peace in the land, Israel, including Gideon, had much to relearn and to reestablish. And what do I mean? Well, by this time in Gideon's life, Israel had already begun to forget God's laws. When the scripture says, "So the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, they forgot the Lord their God, and they served the Baals and the Asherahs," when it says they had forgotten the Lord their God, you can better believe they had also forgotten his laws as well. Thus, Gideon's ignorance of making an ephod and thinking he could set it up as some kind of showcase, and then setting it up in any other location than where the tabernacle rested. So for Gideon to have received this great victory over the Midianites, once delivered, he should have gone back to restore worship to God and the activities of the tabernacle. Had he done so, he would have realized, or would at least been told by the priest, that making an ephod was way out of bounds territory, and that all worship was supposed to come to the place where God had chosen to make his name to abide. And up until the time of King David, that place was Shiloh. Now, we can speculate all day long and say it was pride in Gideon's heart that caused him to do what he did in his latter years. But that wouldn't be fair, nor wise. The scriptures don't tell us that pride rose up in Gideon's heart. We just know that he made a forbidden object and it became an idol to the people. He said, "I won't be your king," but then he had a son whose name meant, "My father is king." But what we can get out of Gideon's last accounts is what Paul taught us. Run the race. Don't get off track. Don't let great victories in your life cause you to stop running the race, because the race is not over until the day you die or until the day that we meet Jesus in the air. Until then, yes, we celebrate our victories and we give God the credit. And then we get right back into the race. Gideon would have done well to write something like what the psalmist wrote many years later. Listen to these words, Psalms chapter 44, verses 4 through 8. "You are my king, O God. Command victories for Israel. Through you, we will push down our enemies. Through your name, we will trample those who rise up against us. For I will not trust in my bow, nor shall my sword save me. But you have saved us from our enemies and have put to shame those who hated us. In God we boast all day long and praise your name forever. Selah." You know, it's almost as though these words were written to describe Gideon's victory. But these are just some of the mistakes that Gideon made. And we would do well to understand and be aware that after we have great victories in our life, stay on guard. Don't drop your shield. Keep your sword up. And keep your running shoes on and finish the race. Now let me close with this. And let's end on a good note with Gideon. In the last battle with the Midianites, Gideon had reduced the enemy's army from 135,000 men all the way down to 15,000 men. Now that's a huge, huge defeat, and he did it all with only 300 men. Now most warriors and generals would have been good just to have called it a victory and called it a day. But Gideon, well, he continued to pursue and fight. Even when his 300-man army was tired and hungry, they pushed on. And they eventually caught up to two of the main kings of the Midianites, and Gideon ended up killing them both with a sword. And it was from these kings that he asked for the earrings, and what did I say to pay close attention to earlier? The crescent ornaments. And that's a huge signal as to who these Ishmaelites worshipped. Understand this, back in these ancient days, ornaments and jewelry and drawings and idols, they were all religious in nature. They represented the gods that they served. Now, let me ask you this. What modern-day religion who absolutely hates the Jews and whose emblem is a crescent moon is active today? If you said Islam, you are correct. Now, this was a discussion I had with Tom earlier this week, unrelated to my lesson. But Islam was not a religion back in the Old Testament days. It was not even a religion in the disciples' days. Muhammad, the prophet of the Islamic faith, didn't come about until sometime around the 6th century. But the practice of moon goddess worship had been an Arabian practice that dated all the way back to the Ishmaelites. And who were they the descendants of? Ishmael, Abraham's son through Hagar. Paul calls him the son of law, whereas Isaac was called the son of promise through Sarah. And if you remember, Ishmael taunted and fought with Isaac when they were just young lads. The fighting and hatred began some 4,000 years ago, and they're still fighting to this day. Now, we won't go into all that tonight, but the point I want to bring up is if you're not paying attention to those sort of words like crescent ornaments, then you're going to miss out on connecting the dots that the very same moon-worshipping enemies that hated Israel back then are the same moon-worshipping people in the Middle East today. And you wonder why God told Joshua to eradicate them all. If Joshua had been successful in finishing out God's direction, then things would be much different today. But God knew all this would play out the way it has. And he knew from before the foundations of the earth were even laid that Jesus would be destined to come and pick up where Joshua left off. And he'd have need to rule all the nations of the earth with a rod of iron. But Gideon, well, he did what he was supposed to have done. And even though he didn't finish as strong as how he started, God still honored him. Let's look at Judges chapter 8, verse 32. Now Gideon, the son of Joash, died at a good old age and was buried in the tomb of Joash's father in Ophrah of the Abrazites. Now, when you read words like, now Gideon, the son of Joash, died at a good old age and was buried in the tomb of his father Joash, that's a strong indicator that he lived a good long life and he was blessed by God. What more could anyone ask for? And this will conclude my lesson entitled, Run the Race, Never Give Up. I'll see you all next week.